Namaste. Welcome to the session on Indigenous research in management. So today it is widely accepted that unlike physical reality, most of the reality which is meaningful for human being is largely constructed by them as an ongoing process of interacting, experiencing and sharing. This applies most appropriately to the subject matter of human sciences. Hence, rather than assuming universality a priori, it is appropriate to consider it more scientific to be skeptical of this assumption. Since every language and every culture has an implicit worldview, first level theorizing in human sciences must be culture or language specific. So, this instance to the creation of concepts and theories has another payoff. Such concepts and theories which are context sensitive, culture and language specific will be better understood by lay people in the respective cultures and would largely overcome the problem of abysmal utilization of social scientific knowledge in our country. In last 3 decades, India's rapid economic growth has made its place in the leading economies of the world, marching on the path of globalization, and more recently by promoting innovation and economic inclusion programs, India is poised for rapid growth and development. Growing middle class, its huge population and 2 trillion economy means its action will have a major global impact. From world trade to climate change to democratization, India now matters. India is unique social and cultural setting because of its diversity, large population, a living culture of more than 3000 years, huge socio-economic divide and one of the fastest growing large economies in the world. India matters not only for economic and political reasons of current times, it matters for its wisdom traditions, the worldviews and ideals of human life expounded therein, its diversity which is unparalleled in the world, its propensity to embrace traditional and contemporary at the same time, and nonetheless its unique challenges and unique solutions to those challenges. Management scholarship is context sensitive in nature and has to be informed by social realities. There is a growing concern for producing useful and credible knowledge that addresses problems important to business and society. An initiative of responsible research led by 10 past presidents of Academy of Management calls for both basic and applied research contributions, valuing plurality and multidisciplinary collaboration with the stakeholders, involvement for service to society and impact on stakeholders. It is high time we examine the management concepts and theories which are working in Indian context or which have the basis in Indian traditional wisdom and can initiate alternative theorizing in the various fields of management. We call it Indian management in this session. So, objective of this session is threefold. First, to identify and recognize the insights in the traditional wisdom and culture that can contribute to modern organizational psychology and management in terms of theoretical models, practical applications and avenues future research. Second, to present the grounded research about Indian culture, its expression at workplace, peculiar features of Indian business system, financial and economic system and institutions and their implications on management. Third objective of the session is to present pedagogical aspect of Indian management. So, in this section, we aim to talk about successful experiments of incorporating Indian perspective in management education and innovative pedagogies to familiarize the participants about unique features of India and relevance and impact of including contemplative practices originating in India in management education. The session include both the conceptual studies as well as problem driven concepts and studies. So, let us go towards the first objective of the session, that is examining the insights from traditional wisdom of India which can have implication on management theorizing and management concepts. Theory and practice in social domains tend to be self-fulfilling. In the famous paper bad management theories are destroying good management practices, late Professor Sumantra Ghoshal explained that unlike a theory in natural sciences like theory about subatomic particles or of the universe, right and wrong does not change the behaviors of those particles or of the universe. If a theory holds wrong assumption, it does not change the phenomena as such. In contrary to that, if wrong management theory or inappropriate management theory is subscribed and adopted by students or followers of the field, that can change their behavior and they may start behaving in accordance with the theory. For an example, a theory that assumes that leadership is immoral and it is about power and influence and less of responsibility and nurturance will promote applying power and influence amongst its subscribers and followers. Similarly, if a theory assumes that motivation is a drive to satisfy individual needs, that will promote the behavior directed to satisfy one individual needs one after another. Whereas, if theory assumes that human life is bound with pious obligations, that will promote duty and pious obligation oriented behavior. In this session, is conceived based on this perspective that many tenets of Indian wisdom tradition have the potential to generate new and alternate conceptual and theoretical models in the field of management. Indian wisdom traditions originated from nature worship. Nature is personified into gods in many places in Vedas, the ultimate source of Hinduism. Swami Vivekananda explained it in his lecture on practical Vedanta. The Sanatan Dharma has the overarching term originally used for so many spiritual paths practiced in the Hindu society in ancient India. That can be loosely translated as eternal truth. So, David Frawley, famous Indologist, translates this term as eternal tradition. That pointed out and summarized its characteristic like it is not limited to any scripture, messiah, church, community or particular historic end, and it embraces a timeless self-renewing reality and divinity in all forms of nature and existence. Notions and concepts arising from the worldview explicated in the Indian traditional wisdom can be source of insights for general living, well-being, personality and its development, learning, society-centric education and role of business in society, etc. Now, I am going to share few promising concepts and tenets to bring home this proposition. So, my first example is about the conception of human life within larger social and natural environment. The recognition of human life to be a part of a larger natural and social environment gives the notion of rina or pious obligations towards family, sages and wisdom traditions, society and all other living organisms in the nature. The notion of rina or pious obligation explains why and how the day-to-day action in the life can attain spiritual significance and can even be considered as the ways and means of one sadhana or spiritual pursuit. So, late Professor S. K. Chakrabarty proposed the giving model of motivation and Rajarsi model of leadership based on these tenets of Indian traditional wisdom. Giving model of motivation says that not need but pious obligation towards all forms of life and wisdom tradition and sages and our forefathers and parents describes and determines the pathway of our life. Similarly, Rajarshi model of leadership suggests that leader needs to have quality of a seer as well as quality of a king. The combination of the quality of seer, which is insightfulness, integrity, connection with the larger social environment, compassion, when combined with the quality of courage and vigor, that makes the perfect personality of a leader, which is termed as Rajarshi model of leadership and which is explained as Rajarshi in our traditional wisdom. So, there are many such constructs proposed and explained based on Indian traditional wisdom, which are and which can enrich the management scholarship. Sattvic leadership, wholesome leadership, karma yoga, spiritual climate, Karta model of leadership are few examples of alternative propositions of contemporary management constructs. So, academicians and the participants who are seeing this video are requested to look at these concepts and incorporate that in their teaching and research. These can be a very fruitful area for research and indigenous inquiry. I'll mention few of these examples. Work of Professor Anand Paranjpe on notion of self, personality and development and synthesis of Eastern and Western tradition in terms of notion of self is an exemplary work which can be built upon for the further research work. Similarly, Dr. Stephen Parker's work on emotions and emotional intelligence and what is the take of yoga and how the yogic tradition can explain the emotional intelligence and emotions is beautifully explained by Professor Stephen Parker. That can be another line of research which has significant impact and potential to present the alternative theorizing in the field of management and particularly in the field of organizational behavior. Ayurveda is a great tradition of well-being of India. Ayurveda not only describes physiological features and suggests the cure for the ailment of the physiological features, but also talk about the mental health, also talks about the positive energy, courage and vigor. Ayurveda has a systematic way of classifying the different personalities and suggesting the precautions and the what do's and don'ts about food and medicines in the form of Vata, Pitta and Kapha. This concept can be further developed and that can be useful for many fields of management like recruitment and selection, development, etc. I would also like to mention the work of Professor Dharam Bhavuk. He has worked on the cultural aspects of creativity and various aspects of Indian culture like dharma, karuna, lajja, daya, prem, shraddha, and he explained that how these notions are different from the contemporary or largely Western conceptualization related to that field. The nuanced picture of Indian culture is captured in the unique Indian constructs which Professor Dharam Bhavuk has explained, and particularly his book on Indian psychology and spirituality based on Bhagavad Gita is full of insights and the potential fields of research in terms of identifying the indigenous constructs and developing those and presenting it for the benefit of the larger mankind. In the same line, I would like to refer the work of Professor Alok Kumar, who teaches at XLRI. Based on the Sankhya philosophy, he has developed a very rigorous instrument on three gunas, sattvic, rajasic and tamasic gunas. And not only that, he has proposed a sattvic leadership approach or sattvic leadership model and published in the Journal of Business Ethics few years ago. Work of Zubin Mulla and Venkat Krishnan is full of insights on karma yoga and how karma yoga is related to different aspects of leadership like moral reasoning, mindfulness and transformational leadership. Last but not the least, my own work is an attempt to synthesize the Eastern wisdom tradition and Western contemporary knowledge in the form of new construct which we call a spiritual climate. We have examined the impact of spiritual climate. First, we have developed the construct of spiritual climate, scale on spiritual climate, and also examined the impact of spiritual climate on learning, innovative behavior, and customer-centric orientation. This work is published in Journal of Business Ethics, Global Business Review, and outcome of the spiritual climate on IMB Management Review Journal. Now, I move to the second objective of this session, that is Indigenous theorizing in the field of management using grounded approach. This aspect of Indigenous management scholarship in India is focused on the grounded research on how Indians think, feel, behave and societal culture of India and its implication on management. Culture in Indian organization, nature and functioning of institutions in India and peculiar practices in Indian organizations or the Indian subsidiaries of MNCs. Professor J.V.P. Sinha explains that most salient feature of primordial Indian mindset is a pluralistic worldview that allows adding new ideas and influences to the old ones, and thus Indians accumulate paradoxical beliefs, values, norms and practices. They smoothly navigate back and forth between them. So, articles on Indian mindset and conditions that provoke them is one of the most well researched grounded work on Indian management and must be part of our research and teaching when we look at the indigenous perspective and indigenous concepts and theories in management. So, culture is conceptualized as values in terms of what we prefer, hold dear or desire. It is also conceptualized as frames, that means filters or brackets that delimit what we pay attention to. Culture also refers to stories, that means a verbal or written narratives with causally linked sequences of events that have beginning, middle and end. Culture is conceptualized as categories, as social construction or classification that defines and structures the conceptual distinction between objects, people, practices and toolkits. So, stories, frames, categories, rituals and practices that actors draw upon to make the meaning or take action, all these things form culture. An important area of exploration is that how these cultural factors affect the workplace dynamics. So, when we talk about grounded theory and grounded approach of management research, it includes how the societal culture of India in all the above mentioned forms affect various aspects of organizational reality. We need to look at the values, frames, stories, categories and tools of Indian cultural aspect and their implication in managing Indian organizations and managing multinational organizations in India. Institutions are another aspect of understanding the social reality of management. Institutions comprise regulative, normative, cultural, cognitive elements that together with associated activities and resources provide stability and meaning to social life. Business system is an institution, and studying the business systems in India can be very useful to understand the Indian management. Business system based research approach require a comprehensive multidisciplinary approach, including need for historical analysis from an evolutionary perspective and interpretive approach by using grounded research such as holistic case studies, historical analysis, studying natural experiments, action research and cross-societal studies. This line of research and management scholarship can be around practices and simply how things are done in Indian organizations and Indian society. I would like to take few examples in this field. A book written by Dr. Kanak Sabhapati very systematically describes the uniqueness of Indian financial and economic system that can be used as a textbook and also the starting point for the research in Indian financial and economic system. He has identified some peculiar things about Indian system, like there is a clear emphasis on family. Since there is an emphasis on family and importance of family is very high for Indians, he connects this tendency with saving habits of Indians. Since Indians make savings for the families, they are less risk taking, and as a result of that, they don't invest much in the stock market, but into more safe avenues of savings. How the small and medium scale enterprises constitute the backbone of Indian economy. It also explains how our labor distribution is reflected when we look at its distribution in the different sectors. There are so many insights there in the work of Professor Kanak Sabhapati. We can use it to sensitize management scholars and students and practicing managers that economic system is deeply connected to financial system, and culture affects the economic system as well as financial system. So, culture has impact on economic system, financial system, as so it has impact on the management system as well. Another line of work I must refer here is pursued by Abhinash Panda and Rajan Gupta. They have very systematically and in very much detail explained the peculiar Indian business system and its implication for management. In the ICCSR volume, their article runs perhaps more than 60 pages, but that has full of insights about how the business system works in India and what are its impact on management. Here, I must explain and mention the work on Indian mindset by Professor J.V.P. Sinha. Professor Sinha, in the series of studies, first identified what is the Indian mindset. He identified there are four predominant Indian mindsets: spirituality based mindset, dependence prone mindset, concern for family, and individualistic mindset. According to the different situation, different mindsets are provoked, and naturally that has impact on organization behavior. His work in the form of different articles as well as his book published by Springer beautifully explains the Indian mindset and socio-psychological realities of India. Social entrepreneurship is again a very important field of inquiry from the indigenous management perspective. India as a society is facing unique problems. Many, many problems are such which cannot be addressed by government alone. For many of such challenges, social entrepreneurship is a promising mechanism. It is growing, it is flourishing in India. We need to give attention to the whole range of social entrepreneurial activities going on in India, and that has impact on alternative theorizing or unique theorizing in the field of management. There is a very interesting work on the Gurukul systems. You might be surprised that today, even today, there are more than 3000 Gurukuls are operating in India. They are preparing students and giving those students for the service of this country. What are the unique things about the Gurukul system? And then there are certain educational settings and institutions which are trying to combine the Gurukul system as well as the modern school system. Work of Professor Ankur Joshi in Banasthali is exemplary in this regard. We can look at his work for more details on how learning and development takes place in the Gurukul, what are its strengths, what are the fields where if the weaknesses are addressed, that can be alternative way of education and development and learning for India. I would also like to mention work of Professor Richa Awasthi. She has studied many Indian MNCs, and she has also studied many Indian companies which are actually the part of the MNCs. Korean MNCs, American MNCs, and Japanese MNCs. How the feature of the organizations change, even if they are MNCs, when they operate in India, what peculiarity emerges in their operations? That is the focus of Richa Awasthi's work. These are the examples of the indigenous management theories which are developed in a grounded manner. Now, I move to the third aspect of this session, that is pedagogy in Indian management. We all are management scholars. Our research and our knowledge creation has to be transferred in the classroom. At the same time, indigenous wisdom can be incorporated for the benefit of the students. that might enhance their well-being and may give them a different perspective of life. So, management is an applied field of knowledge, and research outcome in Indian management needs to be imparted to the management students. There have been some interesting experiments conducted in several management schools in India to impart the insights of the Indian wisdom traditions in management and making the student familiar to the peculiar features of Indian culture and society. I am sure what is happening in different parts of India and various institutions in India is much more than the number of examples I quote in this session. But anyway, let me give few examples, and you might see that similar things are happening maybe in your institute or in the institute you are familiar to. My first example is SP Jain Institute of Management Research. This institute has a compulsory component of internship with the non-profit organizations which are working in the developmental sector, and that requirement for their full-time MBA program and for the MBA students. Lot of corporate leaders who recruit from SP Jain have said that this social immersion program or the internship where the students who are exposed to the development sector develop a different kind of sensitivity towards societal need, and that play a significant role in their decision making process later on when they join the corporate world. So, this program inculcates sensitivity among management students towards social issues of the country. So, a Mandi experiment or marketplace experiment in National Institute of Technology and Industrial Engineering, NITI, Mumbai, is a popular among management student. In this Pandey experiment, the professor aims at building the selling skills among the students. Students have to really and sell the stuff in the marketplace. Management school in Banasthali, Vidyapith University, teaches and incorporates many concepts drawn from Indian wisdom tradition. Karma Yoga project in Great Lake Institute that was initiated by Professor Venkat Krishnan continues even after he left the institute few years ago. The Karma Yoga project engages management students in village service projects that sensitizes the student to the rural society. In the School of Management at IIT Bombay, yoga based practices are used very effectively in the regular MBA course and particularly offered to the first year students. Now, there is systematic research which demonstrates that yoga based practices when incorporated in the management education, and these studies were conducted at IIT Bombay in the School of Management, it enhances the moral reasoning, student engagement and psychological capital of students. So, similarly, we can identify many such fields where Indian insights derived from Indian wisdom tradition or identified in a grounded manner can be incorporated in the management education. So, in this lecture, we touched upon three predominant things. Number one, management scholarship can be enriched by looking at many concepts and the notions present in Indian wisdom tradition. Those concepts can be further developed, examined and presented in conjunction with the contemporary thoughts and contemporary concepts in management. There is a potential in these concepts to enrich the ongoing management discourse. There are many concepts derived from Indian traditional wisdom have potential to look at the phenomena related to organizations and management in different light, and that can give insights about new ways of theorizing in the organization behavior, in marketing or maybe in strategy. Then we looked at the grounded approach of doing indigenous research in the context of India. Grounded research has potential to first develop new categories of Indian culture, behaviors, tendencies and attitudes. So, we need not to rely fully only on the categories developed in the Western world in different culture and force fit our reality into those categories. So, grounded work has a potential to develop new categories of our societal features or cultural features. Third, we touched upon the pedagogy aspect of the indigenous management research. The knowledge gained from Indian traditional wisdom or gained from the grounded approach of examining the societal reality needs to be and can be incorporated in the management pedagogy. That will be a very important way to pass on this knowledge to the new breed of management scholars and management practitioners. These are the three ways through which indigenous management research can be enriched and flourished. So, I hope that this session, where we touched upon the indigenous wisdom, grounded approach of management inquiry in the context of India and pedagogy, will be useful to all of you, and some of us will be inspired to develop new knowledge which practicing managers find useful and management scholars find worth sharing with their students. Thanks for your patient hearing. Thanks very much. Dhanyawad.